Okay, today we're going to be looking at a project. It is a project based on a video which I found on YouTube called Rust Port Sniffer Version 2 Update by tensor-programming. So thank you to you, tensor-programming. Also, they left the version 1, version 2 GitHub links. So I followed the link for version 2, which is the completed project, which he does in the video. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use this as a starting point to help me learn more Rust. The reason being, I've done enough tutorials and I'm thinking that I'm probably avoiding some of the more difficult things by doing too many tutorials. So here we go. One of the things which I've already picked up is this Bpaf and also using mpsc. So mpsc is using channels. And I'm going to be learning more about that as I go through this project. So Tokio, you may or may not have come across Tokio before. It's very popular for any kind of anything that needs reliable network applications without compromising speed. That's typically how you would add it to cargo, the cargo toml. Again, you've got spawn, join handle, which you may have come across. It's for when you've got network blocking rather than CPU band blocking. If you're writing something that's bound by the speed of the CPU, then they recommend you use the Rayon library. So there we go. If your code is CPU bound and you wish to limit the number of threads used to run, you should use a separate thread pool dedicated to CPU bound tasks. Okay, so, and then the BPAF. I don't actually know what BPAF stands for, which bothers me. But yeah, there's loads of documentation on here. But to be honest, the easier way to actually understand how it works is to watch the video. You'll see BPAF. So you've got the hash, then your square brackets, BPAF, and then you've got the options. Options is kind of, don't confuse it with option in Rust. Options are the options which the user sees when they actually run the program. I've gone too far. So if you watch the video, these are the options. So the address start, the address end. So with the port scanner, let's talk about the port scanner. So I haven't really covered that yet. If you've not used it before, have a look at NMAP. So NMAP is kind of the most widely used port scanner, I would say, by number of downloads and just popularity. If you've got a Windows machine or Linux, you can download it and it's command line. I'm not even going to talk about the GUI version because that's not of any interest to me or hopefully to you. Obtaining, compiling. You can verify the integrity and everything in PGP. So let's actually look, what is a port scanner? So this is using the TCP protocol. So ping doesn't use TCP, ping uses ICMP, a different protocol. So we're using TCP, which uses connections. And when TCP tries to create a connection or establish a connection, you send a SYN, then you get the ACK. So basically you start a three-way handshake. So with TCP, we're actually going to be looking at just the initial part of the connection, because that is how we will find out whether the port is going to respond. And if we come down, in fact, go up, you've got different types of responses. So we're going to be interested in open and accepted. So we're going to scan our network on a certain IP address range, and we're going to find out whether it's open, closed, and silence. Silence is no response. So those are the three options, but we're only interested in option one, if it's open. And if you want some more hardcore port scan information, you can also read about it here. This particular page is a Cisco page, about one of their security devices. So they're looking at it from the point of network reconnaissance. So attackers can check what ports are open on your device and potentially try and establish a connection. But also, it's also a way of testing your own network to check what ports have got open. And I've already done it this morning on my home network. And just a little tip, if you're not done much networking, if you use NMAP with a smaller, when I say a smaller mask, it's kind of counterintuitive. So typically you would have like a slash 24, which would be the bit that goes, if you can see this just up here. So you specify your network and then forward slash with the CIDR, the subnet mask. If you use slash 24, it's going to try and scan 254 clients, hosts. If you put slash 29, that narrows it down just to the numbers near the start. So if you know your router is 192.168.1.1, and you only want to scan, for instance, the first, it's not 8 or 16, it's actually 6 or 14, because you have to knock one off at each end. So anyway, if you do slash 29, it just restricts the number of devices that you're going to be scanning for. And if you're only interested in first 8 addresses, then do slash 29. Right, on the left, we've got rust crates, so I've discussed those. What I'm going to talk about next is borrowing a U16. So that was kind of new to me, because I'm still in the first half of a year of learning Rust. I'm going to be looking at ChatGPT, just getting a second opinion from that. I've given you the NMAP tip. Oh, and then I'll talk about what I'm going to do to the code, because basically I will be not plagiarizing, because I'm not going to try and pass it off as my own, but I will be copying mainly the code which I found on GitHub. But I'm going to go line by line. And as you see at the moment, I've kind of done the imports. We've got a constant for the number of the highest ports. We've got a constant for the fallback IP address. And then from line 15, we've got the options. So this is a struct called arguments. And also options is handling the messages to the user, which they will see when they run the binary executable on the command line. You always learn something by looking at someone else's code. And typically, if you tried to do this in Python, you may not have learned very much at all if you already knew Python. But if you come to this and you look at this, why? So when you start learning Rust, you learn that strings, vex, boxes, etc. get stored on the heap. So you start to become familiar that you will borrow those variables or those values. Here we're borrowing. So numbers get stored on the stack. So you think, well, they're cheap to copy. So why would I be borrowing a number, a U16? I'll get to the asterisk in a minute. But so I just wanted a second opinion, and I asked ChatGPT. I thought I knew the reason, but I just wanted to check it. And sure enough, the functions take U16 values as parameters. This is, so the ampersand, I knew the ampersand meant it was borrowing. Sometimes you look at ChatGPT and you think, yeah, I know that. Stop, don't tell me stuff I already know. But if you just persist, eventually it tells you the bit that you actually wanted to know. So by borrowing, you retain the ability to use the original U16 values after calling the functions. So although you might think, well, you typically don't need to borrow numbers, if you're passing them into a function, the function effectively would eat them. That's how I like to think of it. A function eats the things that you pass into it. So they're not available after the function has run. So as you see here, the functions don't take ownership and therefore can't modify the values. This helps prevent accidental modification and provides a safer programming environment. And then I just, while we're looking at ChatGPT, I just quickly asked it to explain the TCP stream connect that Rust uses, and basically it uses the underlying operating system. So depending on your operating system, it will use obviously different libraries. And that's a really basic example where you can see using TCP stream, you've got a target, which is your, obviously that the example.com resolves to an IPv4 address typically. And then the port, which is port 80. So the stream equals whatever you get when you connect to the target. So it's a stream, so you'll be constantly getting receiving data. So yeah, you've seen the start of the code. So at the moment, I've just put in the function definitions, started doing some background reading about why we need to borrow U16s. And so next really I'll be adding the scan function, and then I'll be using the scan function in main. And also, in addition to the code which you saw in the YouTube video, I'm just going to, for kind of learning purposes, I'm going to add some tests. I'll probably put in some nonsensical IP addresses and nonsensical port numbers and see what we get. For instance, I might, you know, I might do 192.257.1.1 and see what we get. Okay, so that's the introduction to what I'm planning on doing. It's always interesting to see how somebody else is going about learning something, especially with Rust, because if you're learning Rust, I'm sure you find it challenging, should we say. So just learn one or two libraries at a time. And if you understand the logic, and you understand the task, or you understand the problem, that's half the battle. So all you need to do then is understand the code. If you try and dive in and start writing some code for a subject that you don't know too much about, then, for instance, if I started trying to learn C# to write a chess engine, I wouldn't know about either of those two things, so I would become unstuck. At least here I do know about networking, so because I know about the networking side of things, it helps me. It saves me having to learn everything from scratch. I don't think it's wise to try and learn a subject and how to write a program using some code which you're still learning. I think everyone's still learning Rust, but just whether you're learning it from a mid-level or senior level. Obviously, a senior developer is still learning Rust. Anyway, I'm digressing. That's probably enough for this video. Give me a thumbs up. Let me know if you have any ideas for how to make the port sniffer better. I'm going to try and stick to the Unix principle, which is do one thing and do it well. So this will just be a port sniffer. Part of me was thinking, oh, I could also make it, you know, do other stuff. I don't know.